večera. Good evening. I will translate to English. I am very pleased to be invited to your center to deliver a lecture and to present you the short history of Czech functionalist architecture, which was quite dominant part of the history of the First Republic, 20s and 30s, when Czechoslovakia had such shape, as you could see on the screen, like a very long fish, like a trout, trying to connect Western and Eastern culture, and also to connect Nordic architecture, Mediterranean architecture. Of course, because of the political development during the 30s, finally this idea collapsed and the Republic disappeared from the map after the tragic Munich Agreement at the end of September 1938. The founder of our republic was Tomáš Masaryk, who was extremely, I cannot see the mouse, how to, can we, you can see the mouse? Yes, yes. Ah, you can see, ah, yes. So this is President Masaryk, who was a founder and a good spirit of that time when Czechoslovakia was a democratic country, and because of the whole atmosphere and political system which was expressed also in architecture. Architecture has one unbelievable feature and benefit that you can read on buildings here in Lvov and Lviv the whole history of the city, and the same you can read in Prague without reading political history, because even architecture is expressing politics, culture, economy, industry, etc. And Czech intelligentsia as a leading force of that time was identified with the new spirit of modern architecture. And that way is expressing also self-confidence, very high culture, and also very high standards of advanced technology, which was always important for Czechoslovakia already before First World War, when Czech industry and Moravian industry was the core of industry of Austrian Empire. I have included to the first picture also sanatorium from Slovakia, sanatorium Machnáč, designed by architect Jaromír Krejcar, who was one of leading personalities in Czech culture at the time. I will mention his biography a little bit later. How to go on? We will speak about architecture of 20s and 30s. I have to mention movement of Prague Cubism, which was initiated around 1910 or a little bit earlier, shortly after Picasso exhibited his Mademoiselle d'Avignon in Paris Salon d'Automne 1907, and Czech artists started to travel to Paris, and also Czech collections of arts traveled to Paris and bought a lot of Picasso works. So if you will come to Prague and if you will visit the Modern Gallery, you will find there 22 Picassos, including the self-portrait of Picasso from the year 1914, which is one of the most famous pictures of the time. It, of course, had an input on the architectural discussion when Czech architects who have been trained partly by Otto Wagner in Vienna, and of course they followed the rationalist stream of Otto Wagner work after 1900, culminating by the Viennese Postsparkasse, and when form should follow function. But I think after 10 years, Czech architects had enough. And they thought, now we have to develop our own style. Form is for us more important. Form will remain, function could change during the following time. And Pavel Janák, whom you could see here, this was a leading theorist of the Cubist group, has written at first one article about Otto Wagner in the journal Still in Prague, but I think half a year later, another article under the title From Modern Architecture to Architecture. And then next article, Cube and Pyramid. So the basic forms which have been so decisive for the Cubist movement. They wanted to develop plastical shapes of facade. They also studied crystal collection and petrographic collection of the National Museums. And they tried to develop eternal architecture, not reflecting only function, but especially form. The first shocking action was the competition for the town hall extension in Prague Old Town Square, when Jozef Gočár designed a new town hall like a pyramid. The whole audience in Prague was completely shocked, and discussion about Cubism in architecture started. But they have also very close contact to some leading art historians in Prague, who at that time started to search Gothic Baroque architecture by Giovanni Santini. Giovanni Santini was an Italian architect acting in Bohemia and Moravia, who reconstructed many Gothic monasteries. But at the end of his career, he built a new funeral chapel on the Green Hill in Zdjar nad Sázavou in Gothic Baroque style. And this was a very, very important inspiration also for Prague architects. And maybe that way, also through these discussions and through this friendship with art historians, Czech architects of the time have been finally quite successful to include new building in historical context of such cities like Prague or Pelhřimov or Telč, etc. As for instance, it is displayed in Black Madonna House in Prague, designed by Jozef Gočár, who is sitting here. This Prague movement was very soon connected with international debate on expressionist art and expressionist architecture in Berlin with gallerist and editor Herbert Walden, who conducted the Sturm Gallery in Berlin and who invited in the 4th, 1913, exhibition of Prague Cubist in his gallery, and just after that he included works of Czech Cubist to the Herbst Salon in Berlin, together with the works of Italian Futurists from Milano, guided by Marinetti, Trampolini, etc. And so through that action, Czech architects from Prague became part of international debate and have been also invited them to take part in Werkbund exhibition in Cologne and in the pavilion designed by Moravian architect based in Vienna, Josef Hoffmann. Four exhibition halls have been dedicated to Prague, a Cubist group. Now, I don't know if I will find the right point to go on. Maybe. Here. But what happened after the war? Of course, during the war, everything was disconnected. Even when Czech architects met in Cologne, in Köln am Rhein, not only Josef Hoffmann, but also, for instance, Henry van der Velde, Belgian architect, who was before the war director of the Kunstgewerbe Schule in Weimar, or they met also Dr. Konrad Adenauer, because Adenauer at the time was a mayor of the city of Cologne. But during the war, not only Czech architects, but also French and German architects, etc., had to design only gravestones for their friends who have been killed during the First World War, like also my grandfather, who was killed in Italy during the last offensive of the Italian army over Vicenza in Asiago battle. But architects who survived in Prague, they became, just after the war, suddenly leading architects of new based Czechoslovakia. So not anymore rebels, nowadays official architects of the new state. So they tried to develop new national style. So this plastical forms of Cubist architecture was suddenly developed to very plastical, monumental style. Sometimes we are using to say that it is sausage style, because some facades look like sausages hanging in Hungarian pusta, because some of these architects also served in Austro-Hungarian army in Austria, like Pavel Janák. It was very short period between 1922 to 1924. But then happened that Le Corbusier came to Prague to lecture, and coincidentally his lecture was located in a building just opposite of the left palazzo, which you can see on my screen. And Corbusier, of course, criticized this building heavily, and it started these comments of Corbusier, and his ideas have changed the architectural debate in Czechoslovakia. And since the mid of 20s, Corbusier become, how we used to say nowadays, guru of the Czech modern architecture. But anyway, there was one little intermezzo around 1924. It was a very strong influence of Dutch architecture, because Netherlands was not involved in the First World War. So the master plan for Amsterdam South by architect Berlage could be executed also partly during the war. So everybody was looking to Netherlands after the First World War. Like after the Second World War, everybody was looking to Sweden, to Stockholm, because Sweden was neutral, and Asplund, Lallerstedt, Leverenz, and the others could build beautiful buildings in Sweden even during the war. So you can see here, for instance, a cabrio bus with Czech students on the way from Amsterdam to Hilversum to visit the chief architect of Hilversum, Willem Marinus Dudok, who was at the time broadly published in Prague and who influenced this short intermezzo of brick civilism architecture influence from Netherlands. I can show you one example of this Dutch influence. This is a little colony of houses for artists which designed Pavel Janák after this cabrio trip to Hilversum for his friends, for painter Vincent Benes, for painter Emil Fila, who have been both acting in Cubist group and have been exhibited in Berlin and also in Cologne. And the third one was a sculptor, Bohumil Kafka, artist who designed this horse sculpture over Prague on Vítkov Hill. So this is his atelier designed by Janák in Ořechovka district, 1924, just after comeback from this trip with his students to Netherlands. And one student who has participated on that trip to Netherlands was Josef Polášek, who has gone to Holland again 3 years later and published a book about Dutch architecture, published by a Czech architectural journal Stil. So this was this little Dutch intermezzo in Czech architecture, also supported by lectures of Dutch architects in Prague, like Berlage, who came to Prague 1924, and also Theo van Desburg as a leading force of the Stil movement, lectured 1924 in Prague and also in Brno. But shortly said, we can say that the development between 1922 to 1925 to modern constructivist and functionalist architecture has gone parallel in three groups. The first group was a group, Deviat Sil, which was an artist club conducted by theorist Karel Tajger with some architects as members like Jaromír Krejcal, Eugen Linhardt, or Jaroslav Fragner, but also many poets like Vítězslav Nezval or Jaroslav Seibert have been very active members of this group. This group has published journals Deviat Sil, Pásmo, and Red, and especially Život, which was a yearbook of Umělecká beseda, and Jaromír Krejcar translated for this yearbook many manifestos of Le Corbusier from the journal L'Esprit Nouveau. So they have been published in Czech, in French language, in this yearbook, and of course influenced broadly the architectural debate. And you can see this development then on these three stages. The first one are sketches of Jaroslav Fragner when he still was a schoolboy, because they had to design in Prague Technical University buildings in Corinthian or Ionic style, and they have been very upset about that. So sometimes on the backside of their sketches, they did another sketches which where they could approve new architectural forms. Like here you can see very hard battle of Jaroslav Fragner between this sausage architecture and between this flatness of purist architecture coming from Le Corbusier office in Rue de Sèvres in Paris. And the next step is a department store designed by his classmate Eugen Linhardt, I think also a little bit inspired by Belgian modernist architecture, which was broadly published also in Prague around 1924. And finally, on the left side, you can see the Olympic department store, very courageous design of Jaromír Krejca, the first really modern department store, which was executed in Prague in the mid of 20s. The building site was visited also by Moscow poet Vladimir Mayakovsky and Ilya Ehrenburg when they visited Prague in the mid of 20s. So this was the first group which also was invited 1923 to present themselves at the first international exhibition at the Bauhaus in Weimar, conducted by Walter Gropius in September 1923. The second group of architects was a little bit elder. They have been mostly students of Jan Kotěra at the Prague Academy of Fine Arts, and they of course had to work on the development of Cubist and Rondo Cubist national tradition, but of course they reflected also the new development in Berlin, because German architectural magazines have been accessible in Prague quite easily. They have known very well sketches by Erich Mendelssohn, for instance, for his Einstein Tower in Potsdam, and the whole expressionist debate in Berlin. And here this not well-known building by Bohuslav Fuchs and his friend Josef Stepanek is expressing this situation, that suddenly it is not only static, stable cubist form, it is dynamic form, in the sense of the famous lecture of Erich Mendelssohn in Amsterdam, 1920, Dynamik und Funktion, dynamics and functions, which is here expressed how could Fuchs and Stepanek illustrate the real function of this building, which was a turbine in this water power plant in a small village in northern Moravia. This group of architects published journal Stavitel. This is a journal which is internationally not so well known, but in this journal, which was published during 20s and 30s, you could find all possible Czech buildings. The other journals have published mostly international buildings from France and Netherlands and Germany, but Stavitel published mostly works of leading Czech architects of that time. And the third group of architects who have been striving for the new constructivist style have been mostly graduates of the Czech Technical University. They have been trying to develop new architecture with the help of new technology and new construction systems. Leading architects of that group have been Oldřich Tyl, who designed the modern gallery nowadays, originally Fair Palace in Prague, or Ludwig Kisela, who built three first department stores at the Wenceslav Square in Prague in the 20s, and they published journal Stavba. They have been all included in the Club of Architects, graduates of Technical University in Prague, or later also in Brno, and they organized in winter 1924 to 25 a lecture series for the new architecture, and they invited at that time leading European architects. At the first arrived to Prague Jacobus Oud, the city architect of Rotterdam. The second one was Walter Gropius, director of the Bauhaus, who was just moving from Weimar to Dessau, and after the new year came also Le Corbusier with his colleague painter Amédée Ozenfant, and at the last arrived Adolf Loos. So quite interesting composition of personalities, and it changed completely then the architectural discussion, especially Corbusier was very successful and dominated in the architectural discussion in Czechoslovakia during the rest of the 20s and during the 30s. Interesting is the comment of Le Corbusier on that cartoon. He said, I have forgotten also to say that his lectures have been one day in Prague and second day always in Brno. So the whole Republic was well informed what is happening. And Corbusier is saying, in Czechoslovakia are very well built ladies. So it seems that ladies have been more interesting for him as Prague, a little bit dry, how he say, Zachriche architecture, so more connected with Germany as with this Cartesian style of France which he conducted. And he used to say, when he has seen this building, this is an interesting building, but it is not yet l'architecture, because Corbusier wanted to have not a normal staircases, he wanted to have ramps like he later proposed in his Central Soyuz building in Moscow, in Myasnitskaya Ulitsa, or how he proposed in many buildings after the war, for instance, in Chandigarh. Corbusier was in Prague, but already before the First World War. He traveled from Berlin, 1911, to Istanbul, and by the way, he stopped in Prague. At that, the ramps have been already in his head. You can see here two sketches of Corbusier from 1911 from Prague, and you can see how important for him was the topic promenoir architectural. This is a ramp connecting Nerudova Street in Prague with the castle square and entrance to the castle, and second sketch is from the same point, looking on the other side of the same situation under the Prague Castle. And I can show you also Corbusier from his later visits. In this picture down below, you can see Corbusier arriving to Prague Central Station in January 1925, and he came then last time to Prague in October 1928, and here he is standing on the terrace of Karel Taige apartment with Oldřich Till and other Czech architects. So these have been these three visits of Corbusier which have been decisive for the development. And after the lecture in January 1925, appeared in Czechoslovakia first Corbusian buildings. Maybe the really first one was the own house of the architect Eugen Linhart, who traveled for his wedding trip to Stuttgart and to Paris to see Villa Garche, etc. And then he built his own house, and as you see, here is already the ramp connecting two levels of living room in his living hall in the villa in Prague. Davidce, he also used the Corbusian golden section proportional system, and this house we can regard as the first Corbusian villa in Prague. When we can see this building and then also bigger buildings which have been later built in Prague or in Brno, we have to try to answer one important question. Who was the client of these architects, of this architecture? In Germany, the client was social democratic government, like Martin Wagner and Bruno Taut conducted the erection of Berlin Siedlungen, and they built during 20s, during the Weimar Republic, 135,000 flats in Berlin. It was a very important social action. The same happened in smaller scale in Frankfurt or in other cities in Germany, and also the same situation was in Holland, because mostly the government in Holland was social democratic, and the main dominating topic in architecture was social housing. In Belgium and in France, the client was intelligentsia and upper middle class, like villas designed by architect De Koning in Ickel, nearby of Brussels, or in the suburb of Brussels, or like Corbusier clients for the Villa Garche or for the Villa Savoie. And client of Czech modern architecture was intelligentsia, very young intelligentsia and very young bourgeoisie, because this young generation found identification with this modern spirit of new, open, democratic life, and it was very soon expressed even in bigger tasks, in administrative buildings, in factories, etc. Like, for instance, in Prague, electricity headquarter designed by, at the time, young architects Adolf Bench and Oldřich Kříž, and shortly after that, when Havlíček and Honzik won a competition for the Prague General Insurance Company. And this style spread out to the whole country, also to smaller cities, like, for instance, to Kolín, which is a city on the Elbe River, 60 kilometers eastwards from Prague, where Jaroslav Fragner, at that time just 30 years old, built a huge power plant in really Bauhaus spirit, and that's why he was titled with a nickname Czech Gropius, because it's very similar to Gropius' style. And also this photograph was done by one artist who studied at Bauhaus in Weimar, and later he built also Tatra sale house with salon with Tatra cars in parterre on pilotis, glass salon, and in upper floor was the apartment of the owner. The whole movement also found very soon a second center in Brno, which had a very specific situation, because Brno is closer to Vienna as Prague. Brno is only 130 kilometers from Vienna and 200 kilometers from Prague. And President Masaryk had an idea to locate also some important state offices to Brno. He was against this centralization, this centralizing, like we can see in Paris, in France. So that's why he delegated some competencies to the capital of Moravia. And it was a great challenge for young architects, because they have had a feeling that there will be a lot of work for them. So architects who finished studies in Vienna, and also architects who finished studies in Prague, moved to Brno and catched this challenge. Like Ernst Wiesner, architect who studied Viennese Academy and who was admirer of Adolf Loos and his such now modern traditionalism, who built his most famous building, the crematorium at the central cemetery in Brno. And at the same cemetery, Bohuslav Fuchs, a leading architect who studied in Prague, built a funeral chapel. And if you will compare this building, you can see the whole polarity of the situation in Brno in the mid of 20s. On one side, the modern, traditional architecture by Wiesner, Jewish architect, born in Slovakia, but acting in Brno whole time, and Bohuslav Fuchs as a representative of a young Czech intelligentsia was obviously inspired by Dutch, the Still movement, but also by Unity Temple, by Frank Lloyd Wright in Oak Park in Chicago. In Brno, capital of Moravia, was also founded the New School of Architecture 1920, and in the mid of 20s, first graduates of this school could start their work, like, for instance, Josef Kranz, very talented and poetic personality, who built very soon Era Café, which is a very beautiful, I would say, transformation of Mondrian picture in architecture, with this beautiful facade and also with quite colorful interiors. To the School of Architecture in Brno was invited a new professor, Jiří Kroha, who played in 20s and 30s quite positive role, but in Stalinist time very negative role. During 20s and 30s he studied analysis and comparison of living conditions between wealthy people and between poor people, and made an exhibition about that topic. However, for himself and for his family, he built quite luxury villa in the west end of Brno, where several very often met members of the avant-garde, like here you can see a little bit drunk Czech poet Vítězslav Nezval, famous representant of Czech poetism and surrealism in poetry. And here is sitting and tasting Slivovitz Karel Tiger, the theorist of the avant-garde, and the man who is serving Slivovitz on the sinking Bauhaus table in the garden of that villa is Roman Jakobson, who was one of founders of Prague structuralist circle of linguistic group in 20s. So you can see here very poor life of leftist intelligentsia in Prague, because they didn't know what is communism in reality. But I have already mentioned the name of Bohuslav Fuchs, who was really dominating person in Brno and who built a lot for the city. He served also 4 years as a city architect, but at the same time, besides of it, he was running his own office, so he built a lot for the city, but also for private clients. His the most famous building is Avion Hotel in Brno, in the very narrow building lab, which is only 8 meters, 35 centimeters broad, and 34 meter deep. And on that situation, Fuchs developed very interesting spatial solution of the interior, such known Raumplan, to say it with Adolf Loos, where you could see from the fourth level, from the gallery, through the whole body of the building to the entrance, as you can see it on that photo. It was one of the most interesting spatial creation at the time, and of course it was immediately discovered, and the building was published together with Breslau, Werkbundsiedlung, and Hans Scharoun, Bornheim, in the Werkbund journal Die Form in Berlin. He built also a lot for the city, like many schools, and only in Brno 3 swimming pools for workers. Here is maybe most interesting complex of a school and dormitory school for women profession, which is maybe the first building where one Czech architect from Brno influenced one famous architect abroad. I had a chance once to look files in the archive of Giuseppe Terrani, architect from Milano, and in these files I found a little extract from the journal Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung, and it was a photograph of Fuchs' dormitory. And these composition principles of grid of loggias transferred then Giuseppe Terrani in his main facade of the Casa del Fascio, which was built 3 years later at the main square of Como, just opposite the cathedral in this Lombardian city. However, the most important action opened, inaugurated for the 10th anniversary of Czechoslovakia was the erection of the Brno International Fair, where have been included buildings designed by leading architects from Prague and in Brno, like for instance the pavilion of the city of Brno, designed by Bohuslav Fuchs, the main pavilion designed by Prague architect Kalous, and then the exhibition tower designed by Bohumír Čermák, and who built also in Rutenia a lot. And interesting is that the detailed photograph of this exhibition tower used Bruno Taut as a frontispiece at the first page of his book, Die Neue Baukunst in Europa und Amerika in Stuttgart, just 1 year after the opening of Brno Fair. In occasion of the opening of Brno International Fair was also organized the first Werkbund Estate exhibition in Czechoslovakia in Brno. It was a relatively modest action of two young building entrepreneurs who invited eight architects to build family houses or double houses or triple houses in a small estate in Wilson Forest in suburban area of Brno. The result was economical disaster. They have taken credit from the bank and they have not been able to sell the houses. They could sell only this double house designed by Wiesner and rent a double house designed by two young students. The other houses remained long time empty, and it was a disaster for this building company. But anyway, this was a lesson for Prague Werkbund, who later, 3 years later, organized exhibition Baba in Prague West End. One goal of this exhibition was also to explain to broader audience the change also of the role of women in the society. So just a few months later, after the opening of the Werkbund Estate in Brno, was organized exhibition Zivilisierte Frau, the civilized woman, showing that women should have a help in laundry and in the kitchen, modern technology, etc. And interesting is this poster of the exhibition. Hairs have been cut. And I have one hypothesis that the Czech film director Jiří Menzel has seen this poster, because this poster was shown in the 70s in one Prague exhibition museum for decorative arts, and used this idea in one sequence of his famous film when Magda Pašáriová is running on the bicycle to the frisbeer, and she is coming to the frisbeer and asking him, please cut me my hairs. And he is shocked and he accepted this command, but he was crying. So the old era was over and the new era started, and Jiří Menzel did one of the best sequences of his film. And now we will go to Prague to see the Baba exhibition. I told you that the economical disaster of the Brno estate was a lesson for Prague, so the Prague Werkbund decided to found a circle of friends of Werkbund, potential clients, and they could select architects, members of Czech Werkbund, and they could build family houses. But of course, everybody wants and is dreaming to have his own chateau, own castle. So nobody wanted to build triple houses and double houses. So in Prague have been built only family houses, or family houses with two flats, or family houses with studio, because some of clients have been quite prominent Czech artists, like Ladislav Sutnar, leading graphic designer who played such a role like Wagenfeld in Germany, or Pavel Janák, chairman of Czechoslovak Werkbund, or also director of National Theater, director of Prague Fair, etc. So this was the standard of clients in these estates. We have not too much time to speak about Baba, because it would take 2 hours. So I will show you only three villas from that estate. All three have been designed by one upcoming star of luxury housing architect Ladislav Žák. He built this first house for the director of the Museum of Decorative Arts, Dr. Karel Herein, with strip windows and terrace looking to the Cathedral of St. Vitus in Prague, so quite good view to the valley of Vltava. As a second house, he built a villa for professor of geometry, so you see the facade is quite geometric with the bullet window to the staircase, and again with strip windows to the valley on the south facade. And last but not least, he built the third house in the estate for a lawyer, Dr. Zaurálek. He visited as a student in 1925 l'Exposition des Arts Décoratifs in Paris with his teacher Joseph Gochard, and all these students of Gochard have been completely impressed by the pavilion L'Esprit Nouveau by Corbusier, and since that time they have been also dreaming one day to build Maison d'Habitation, a big collective house with cells for families with terraces, which could offer also the comfort of family houses in a big unit which has a metropolitan scale. And so somehow Jacques here has developed a prototype of such living cell which could be used for the bigger Maison d'Habitation. The principle is that downstairs there was a longitudinal living room with a covered terrace, and in upper floor there was open terrace framed by the corniche, which was a typical feature of Jacques architecture. Jacques was quite successful with his three villas, and he designed also interiors not only of his own villas but also of some other villas, and became soon star of Czech villa architecture in Prague. I will show you his three villas which he built after that. The first one he built for the aircraft designer Dr. Hein, which is, as you see, the extended version of the third house of the Baba estate, with cabin-like bedrooms upstairs, longitudinal living room downstairs, covered terrace downstairs, and open terrace upstairs, but also something like a jumping bridge over the house where Mr. Hein could stand and check and control his airplanes, because the house was located only 3 miles away from the military airport in Prague, Belly. And Madame Hein could rest on the terrace, so quite good division in old style in the family. So this was his first house, which was quite successful and was published, of course, in L'Architecture d'aujourd'hui in Paris, was published in famous book by Frederick York in London, The Modern House, and also it was published in Buenos Aires before the war. But it was not enough. He built then also a villa for famous Czech film director Martin Fritsch in the south end of Prague. In this case, the living room is in upper floor, and downstairs are bedrooms and bathroom. And of course, there is an open terrace upstairs. And as a last villa which he built a villa for the famous Czech actress and diva Lida Bárová. I don't know if you have heard about Lida Bárová. She was quite successful young actress in Prague, but then she was invited to Berlin and to Potsdam to DEFA studio, and unfortunately she became a fiancé of Joseph Goebbels, so it destroyed her career. And Jacques designed for her, I would say, double villa, because it was villa for her parents. She had also one sister, so her sister and the family lived in this part, and she had this annex with own entrance, without kitchen. Probably mama was cooking for her, or there was a catering. But she had a boudoir here, and then she had the terrace on the roof, where she could use sunshine without any dress, and she could look directly to the cathedral of Prague. So, but she has not lived there. She was at the time already in Berlin, and after the war she escaped to Düsseldorf and she died in Salzburg. The family ended with a tragedy because her sister committed suicide in 1945, because her famous sister was attacked as a collaborateur, etc., etc. So this was the end of Jacques' activity in building of luxury residential houses. But as you have seen here, the villa for upper middle class, these are photographs of the villa now, because now one client bought the villa and he properly reconstructed the house. This is a terrace in front of the living room, and there was also this private terrace of Lida Bárová on the roof. But as I mentioned, the family house for the upper middle class became really experimental field for architects, where was displayed the whole polarity of the functionalist architecture, from very rational concepts, like in this case, a villa built in steel skeleton construction designed by young couple Oskar and Eli Eller from Ostrava, but in Prague, very beautiful building on one side of this polarity, and on the other side of the style spectrum, we can find also buildings built in organic or dynamic, aerodynamic style. In Germany they are using to say Schiff architecture. One of these architects was Vladimir Greger. He was a very good friend of father of Václav Havel, and he built building parcels on Barrandov Hill, owned by Havel family, houses, one of them for Dr. Chelakovsky in quite interesting aerodynamic style. And he also designed famous train Slovak Blitz, which operated between, produced by Ringhofer company in Prague, and which was operating between Bratislava and Prague, and also between Ostrava and Prague. When I have gone first time to Prague, I still could have a privilege to use this Slovak Blitz, which you could find nowadays only in museums, in traffic museums. And also another inspiration for such architects was a Czech advanced technology in car production. This is a famous Tatra 77, which was exhibited 1936 in Berlin Auto Salon, and 1 year later was developed Tatra 87, quite famous car, and just after the war, Tatra Plan, Tatra 97. leading cars in European industry of automobiles. Also my father was connected with this style because he studied with Hans Scharoun in Breslau and worked in his office in Berlin. This is a villa for veterinarian on the Polish, at the time German border in Lucin, where you can see also this battle in the mind of architects. On the north facade is more Corbusian with strip windows, and south facade is like open arms to the sunshine. My father is sitting here on one chair, and he is 25 years old. So you can see that although these architects have been very young, and then 2 years later he built another villa over the Ostrava industrial city with a beautiful living room with two levels, with 18 meter long window opening the living room to the view on the industrial city of Ostrava. So as you see, the intelligentsia, the upper middle class, moved to quite high standard villas in west ends of the city. But Karel Teige, as a leader of left avant-garde, was dreaming how to develop social housing and minimal apartments. He founded in 1929 a left group of architects and tried to convince them that for two competitions for minimal housing in Prague, they should design collective houses inspired by Moisey Yakovlevich Ginzburg from Moscow and from the journal Savremennaya Architektura. They really designed such prototypes, which have been also presented on the Siam Congress in Brussels. But there came to conflict between Teige and between Corbusier and Siegfried Gideon and others, because this plan also proposed that children should be separated from parents and they should be kept in special nursery, because then you can better fulfill them with Marxist and Bolshevik theories. So it's much better, but not good for families. So we can be happy that the city council in Prague and city council in Brno has not accepted this idiotic Bolshevik proposal, and they built only social housing for normal families, quite modest, small housing with 40 square meters, but with a state subvention in Prague and also in Brno. I have mentioned two important centers of modern movement of 20s and 30s in Czechoslovakia, Prague and Brno. And there was a third one, and it was in Zlín, in the center of the Batya, headquarters of the Batya shoe company. Batya started his job in 1894, and the city of Zlín had 2,500 inhabitants. In the mid of 30s, the city had over 50,000 inhabitants and produced a quarter million of shoes daily. So it was the most dominating shoe industry in Europe, and the nickname of Batya was Czech Ford. And he, of course, was inspired by American technology and production systems. In early 20s, his stepbrother brought from America plans of American factories, and then he developed unified style of the city of Zlín. Everything is built in brick. Workers have been accommodated in family houses, double houses, or four family houses. Then there have been dormitories for singles. And all public buildings and industrial buildings have been built in steel skeleton system with a module 6.15 meters, which was transferred from feet system from 20 feet. And of course, this skeleton was fulfilled by bricks. So somehow like a predecessor of brutalist architecture after the war. Leading architect of the company was Vladimir Karfik, who was trained before at the Czech Technical University in Prague and then in the office of Corbusier and long time in the office of Frank Lloyd Wright in America. At the end of the 30s, he built also the headquarters of the company with one very specific detail. There is an elevator as a studio of the boss, and the boss could stop in every floor and control all his collaborators are really working for the family, for the company, or if they are reading newspapers or sport news, etc. So it was quite useful for the boss. And it's interesting museum piece nowadays. If you will visit Zlín, you can use this elevator because it was reconstructed. Corbusier was invited by Jan Batia in the year 1935 as a member of the jury for competition for small houses of the company. Here you can see Corbusier with Vladimir Karfik, here with Bohuslav Fuchs and with the city architect Kahura. And Batia also asked Corbusier to design few things for him. The first one was a master plan which should develop the area between the city center of Zlín and factory and between the satellite city Otrokovice. Of course, Corbusier used it to offer to Batia to build groups of high-rise dwelling houses, maison d'habitation type, and Batia of course rejected to build it because he used to say we have to work together but we have to live separately in family houses in English garden cities. The same happened also with proposal of Le Corbusier for the Batia pavilion for the World Exhibition in Paris. And there is another interesting case. He also designed standardized department stores for France. And although this project Batia has not accepted, but what happened? 1 year later, he built his own department store on Karlstraat in the central Amsterdam, signed by Batia company and one partner architect in Amsterdam without mentioning Le Corbusier. A little plagiat taken from Le Corbusier, and of course Batia has not paid any penny to Le Corbusier. There was a long correspondence between them. As I have shown you, there was a very high level of architectural culture, which was also caused because of opened connection to the world. So many Czech architects could work in foreign offices. Here you have no smoking office in desert in Arizona, office of Frank Lloyd Wright, and here is sitting Vladimir Karfik during his training time in America between 1926 to 1930. Here is my father and his twin brother, my uncle, observing from Empire State Building, the Chrysler Building, during their stay in New York. Here is Jaroslav Fragner with another Czech surrealist painter, Josef Šíma, on the balcony of his flat in Paris. And this is here the last visit of my father in Berlin, together with his teacher, Hans Scharoun, at the garden of the Villa Bench in Berlin, Spandau. It was already in the Nazi time that day. It was the last visit of my father. Then he couldn't see his teacher 27 years. They met again at first 1963, just after Scharoun built the famous Berlin Philharmonic Hall for Herbert von Karajan. Like these practices of Czech architects and experiences in abroad, also important have been lectures and visits of foreign architects in Prague. I mentioned this lecture series for the new architecture 1924-25, but also in the 30s, a lot of leading architects visited Prague or Brno, like Hannes Meyer. When he finished his activities in Soviet Union, he held 22 lectures in many Czechoslovak cities about Soviet architecture. This is poster of his lecture in Bratislava, designed by Bauhaus student Zdeněk Rosman. And here is a document of the meeting of Czechoslovak, Polish and Hungarian architects, members of Siam Group in Zlín and in Brno, attended also by Madame Le Mandrot, owner of the Chateau La Sarraz, where was Siam founded. But you can see here also Madame Helena Sirkus from Warsaw and Szymon Sirkus from Warsaw, or Roman Piotrowski, later architect who built a beautiful building in Gdynia and harbor, and also later ambassador of Poland in Germany and minister of building after the war, and many Hungarian architects. To finish this survey of international connections, I would like only to show quite quickly few proposals or buildings by foreign architects in Czechoslovakia. Here you have a competition for the hotel in Brno, designed by Oud from Holland and Peter Behrens from Berlin, but at the time Peter Behrens was professor on Schillerplatz in Vienna. Here is another bank proposal by Behrens in Prague, besides of Powder Tower in the center of the city. And here is the last building which Erich Mendelssohn built before he left Berlin after the Machtergreifung 1933, the department store in Ostrava. Also, Dutch architects have been involved, like Mart Stam, who built as the only foreigner one villa at the Baba Estates, and here are other projects by Oud, by Johannes Dyker, who is famous for his sanatorium Sonnenstrahl in Hilversum and for his Hotel Hoyland in Hilversum. There are also examples of such now German Schiff architecture designed by Thilo Schoder, who was a longtime assistant of Henry van der Velde in Weimar and built a beautiful expressionist villa in Liberec. And Heinrich Lauterbach, one of close friends of Hans Scharoun, built two villas in Jablonec in Northern Bohemia, one for Czech industrialists, Mr. Hasek, and one for German client, for Mr. Schmelowski, who was a physician. But the biggest commissions from all foreigners received Jozef Plečnik, architect from Ljubljana, who was a very close friend of Jan Kotěra during their studies at the Otto Wagner school at the Schillerplatz. And later Kotěra recommended Plečnik for the chair of architecture at the School of Decorative Arts. And after the First World War, Plečnik became architect who reconstructed and converted Prague Castle as a residence and office of President Masaryk. At the time, we had a president who could read books and he could also write books. It happened only once later when we had a fantastic personality of Václav Havel. Usually we have analphabets. I wouldn't like to comment the situation nowadays. Anyway, Plečnik had a small group of students and he had a very deep impact on their education and on their creations. He, outside of the castle, he built only the Holy Heart Church in Prague, Vinohrady, very beautiful church, which is somehow like a predecessor of a postmodern movement, but 45 years earlier. Very beautiful interior. I would recommend you to visit this church. It's open every day between 8 to 9 because of the service, otherwise the church is closed. And now we are slowly at the end. I hope you are still not totally fatigued, totally tired. Could you still tolerate maybe 4 minutes and 56 seconds, then I can finish the lecture. Okay, at the end I would like to show you a typological spectrum of buildings in which Czech architects really reached very high international level. One of these types was a luxury apartment in Prague, designed mostly by young architects in the 30s, especially by Eugen Rosenberg. Rosenberg was a Slovak Jew who studied at first at the Bratislava Technical High School. It was not enough for him, so he moved to Brno. He studied at the Technical University in Brno and worked for Bohuslav Fuchs, but it was not for him enough, so he moved to Prague and finished his studies and made his diploma at the famous master school of Josef Gočár at the Prague Academy. But even this was not enough for him. He moved to Paris and worked for Le Corbusier in the office in Rue de Sèvres, and nowadays was founded that discovered that he was a draftsman for the Corbusier's own apartment at the Porte Molitor in Paris. And when he came from Paris, he had already experienced his designing of apartments. And he'd been in Prague six big apartments in Holešovice, in Letná, and in Nové Město, mostly with this proud combination between strip window, loggia, and winter garden. Richard Pozzerli also built beautiful apartment house in Davice, etc. I could show you 20 examples of this style in Prague, but anyway, initiated by Eugen Rosenberg, who escaped at the beginning of the war, and he worked then during the war and shortly after the war in the Mars Group in London together with Sir Patrick Abercrombie. And then after the war, he founded a company, York Rosenberg Mardall, which was the most successful British architecture firm from late 40s to 90s. Very high standards of production was reached in hospital buildings. Here is, for instance, a dermatological pavilion at the Prague Hospital in Bulovka, in the north of the city. Here is an old photograph and situation today. And of course, also school buildings. I have shown you Fuchs school. And here is a French secondary school in Prague, designed by Jan Gilar, who worked also for Ruthenia. He designed new rail station for Užhorod, which was not built only because of the collapse of Republic 1938. But this school, which is located just behind the architecture faculty, is always my goal when I am teaching Erasmus students of Prague from all European countries. My tour, my pilgrimage is going always to French secondary school because it's an extremely good example of spatial solution and distribution of functions inside of the building, and all children are very happy there. Very important also was the erection of arcades in a close connection to Wenceslas Square. So you could go not through Wenceslas Square down, but you can go around Wenceslas Square and passing a lot of passages with lighted roofs, etc. Sometimes with a roof which could move. And when sunshine is coming, sun is coming directly to the passage, like in Verkund Passage or Národní třída, or very beautiful is a sequence of three spaces in black rose on Příkopy Street, Am Graben, in the center of Prague. The spirit of new architecture was also presented in Czechoslovak pavilions in international expositions, like in Liège, in Paris. This is this Gočár pavilion from the year 1925, or in Brussels, 1935, or in Chicago, designed by Camille Rochecotte. I think I have a duty also to show two buildings from Ruthenia. When we have here Lina from Užhorod, I had to include here also two buildings from Ruthenia. The children hospital pavilion designed by very young architect Jaroslav Fragner, 1924, and the post office by Gočar designed at the turn of 20s and 30s at the important corner of Užhorod in the center of the city. I think these reliefs are designed by Jan Lauda. I am not sure.
I don't know yet.
I think it could be Lauda who worked with Gočar, but I am not sure. We have to specify this problem. So this was a spectrum of buildings from the typological point of view, and a little reminding of Ruthenia as a part of Czechoslovakia. And now we are slowly at the end of the lecture, so I would like to remind you, because I have spoken about houses for existential minimum, I will show you now two houses for existential maximum. The Loos House in Prague, where he demonstrated his famous idea of Raumplan, of the spatial solution of the house in cube, but inside the specific functions have a specific height, and also there was a penetration and connection between functions spatially. This is also a project which allowed a lot of social games inside of the house. I can explain you. Look, in the second floor, there is a gentleman's library with a chimney and library and his working table. But when he wants to visit his lady, he has to go few steps up, and then here is a boudoir of the lady, which has two levels. In upper level is a space like a salette, like a Viennese salette. The lady could sit on the divan, on the sofa, and look through the window to the salon, what is happening in the main living room. And when the gentleman is entering her door, she can also disappear when she is not happy with this visit, because she has a private staircase here. So as you see, it was a fantastic solution. Maybe that's why Madame Müller, I met her as a young student, and she always told me that Loos was a fantastic man, a second young man, 60 years old young man. But then, when she was old, she had troubles, because everybody who is old has problems with many stairs, and the house is on the stairs. So you can build such villa only for young people, not for elder people. But Loos was so happy with this village that he celebrated here his 60th birthday. Here is the company. You can see here Mr. Miller, his client, and Mrs. Miller. This is Loos' last wife, Claire Beck from Pilsen. And here is Adolf Loos. And who came to Prague to celebrate with Adolf Loos? Karl Kraus came to Prague to celebrate with them. And there are some Czech important members of intelligence, like art historian Matějček, like poet Josef Svatopluk Machar, and on the left side, Bohumil Markalos, who translated Loos' essays in Slere gesprochen in Czech language. If you look the living room, you have to think that at that time people had not video screens, etc. They had simply aquariums. So here are two aquariums of the family, and the connection between dining area and the salon of the house. So this was one house for existence maximum. And we have another one, but I cannot find how to move now the picture. Here. So this is the second house for existence maximum, designed in Brno by Ludwig Mies van der Rohe for very wealthy couple, Margaret and Fritz Tugendhat. 1931, just after the house was opened, the German Werkbund journal Die Form organized an enquete, a discussion, how to live in the Villa Tugendhat. Then they asked several architects, some have been for the villa, like Ludwig Hilbesheimer, but several Marxist theorists and critics have been against the villa because it was too much luxury. But they also asked the clients, and they both responded to this question separately, but in the same way. We can live only in the Villa Tugendhat, but they lived there only 8 years, and then they had to escape because of the Nazis to Venezuela, and later to Switzerland, where they both died. And now we are really at the end of the lecture. I again forgot how to move. No, it's late. At the end, I would like to repeat three names, for me, most important architects of this period. The first one is from Brno, Bohuslav Fuchs, who was named by poet Jakub Demel, the man of action. When Fuchs got a commission, he was a bulldozer. He was able to build the house. So he built approximately 200 houses on a very high level, like his own villa, which you could see here, with a maisonette system of living room, with a beautiful cubist style life made by Emil Fila from Prague, or like his swimming pool in Brno. In the 30s, then he moved to organic architecture when he built this beautiful swimming thermal pool in Trenčanske Teplice, titled Green Frog. Beautifully located in the old quarry, a really prominent example of organic architecture in Czechoslovakia, parallel to the work of Hans Scharoun in Germany. He was, after the war, professor of the Brno School of Architecture, but he was kicked out by communists at the end of the 50s, and then he lived in diaspora to the end of his life. He died in 1972. All these three architects, which I wanted to mention at the end, have been students of Jan Kotěra. So it means these roots are going, like architecture in Lvov, to Otto Wagner and to Vienna. The second one of them we could title Enfant Terrible, Jaromír Krejcar, who translated Corbusier manifestos at the beginning of the 20s. He built in the same spa like Bohuslav Fuchs in Trenčanské Teplice, a beautiful sanatorium in early 30s. Then he married Milena, the lady for whom Kafka has written his famous letters. Then he divorced and he escaped to Soviet Union and worked with Moises Ginsburg in Moscow, but then he was totally shocked with the new Stalinist doctrine and emigrated back to Czechoslovakia. And then he immediately won competition for the Czechoslovak pavilion at the Paris World Exhibition 1937 and built one of the most beautiful pavilions over the Seine River. 1948, he emigrated to London because he has known what is coming from Moscow to Prague after the coup d'etat of communists, and he died in London as a teacher at the Architectural Association School. The third one, after the first one, Fuchs, was a man of action. The second one, Krejcar, was an enfant terrible. The third one, Kamil Roškot, we could say that he was a Plato, a philosopher of the architecture. He was not thinking on minimal dwellings, etc. He had a dream to build big cultural buildings, and he won nearly all important urban competition for the city of Prague. And he built, for instance, this small but very beautiful theater in this city, Ustina Dolici, in eastern Bohemia. And then he also designed gravestones of Czech kings in the crypt of Prague Cathedral. Very unusual task, but he did it really by brilliant way, with the coffin of Charles IV in the middle from bronze. The other coffins are from marble. And finally, this is a symbolical thing, he won competition for Czechoslovak pavilion in New York and built somehow the tomb of the whole Czechoslovakia, because the pavilion was opened at the moment when Czechoslovakia disappeared from the map. And on the facade, he used interesting quotation by Czech philosopher and pedagogue Jan Amos Komenský, Comenius. And it is also interesting story, because this quotation used Masaryk during his inaugural speech when he was elected president. Second time, Kamil Rožkot used it on the facade of this pavilion at the moment when Czechoslovakia disappeared from the map. And third time, the same quotation used Václav Havel when he was elected president. So it's a fantastic rainbow of the history of these 20 years. And I think it's a good moment to finish and to liberate you. I am sorry for my English and that I have taken you so much time. Ďakujem.
Zaraz, maybe you are not so tired and
Okay.
Якщо маєте запитання, то можемо розпочати дискусію, тому що зараз якраз попросимо пана Владі про професора вдягти наушники.
Наушники. Слухам. So it will be translated.
Translated.
I would prefer to hear Ukrainian melody.
Ви почуєте, якщо знімете один наушник, можете чути обидві мови.
А що?
Так, прошу.
Okay, I'm wondering who was that first architect who started to design the round windows in the modern style.
What kind of
round windows? Yeah. Round? Who was the first? Do you know?
Illuminatus.
And second question: What is your favorite modernist building in Lviv?
In Lviv, I will start with the second question. I was walking today to the Polytechnical University, and by the way, I have seen a complex of apartment houses designed by Jewish architects who came from Vienna, and it was very beautiful building, so I like it. And I have seen a lot also of official buildings, of office buildings and public buildings on the exhibition of Lviv architecture in the Architecture Museum in Wroclaw. What was funny was that there was also on the gallery sequence of old movies, which have really explained the spirit of life of Lviv before the war. So it was quite successful exposition, which is now shown in the Muzeum Narodowe in Krakow. Hopefully it will cross the border also to Ukraine. So this is, for instance, my favorite building, this apartment house with a round glass corner. And who designed the round window? This is difficult to say, because I think we could find also in Gothic architecture round bullets in French cathedrals and in many also Central European cathedrals. And you can find a round window also in Baroque time, And I think also in the work of Josef Hoffmann in Vienna, we could find a round window. And Corbusier, Charoun, my father, they all designed round windows. So it is nothing new. It's a very old principle.
Ще запитання?
Я буду українською, якщо можна. Дуже дякую вам за лекцію. Взагалі вражає архітектура. І я хочу спитатися про сучасний стан архітектури модернізму в Чехії, в Україні. Це велика проблема. Ми мали гостей і 2 роки тому школу, і мали гостей з Росії, архітекторів і архітектурних критиків, які також говорили, що це величезна проблема. Ми маємо в Львові дуже багато будинків, які є настільки, які є в приватній власності, бо це також є якби віли чи приватні будинки, які є до такої міри перебудовані вже новими власниками, які мають інше уявлення про і красу, і функціональність, напевно, що ці будинки важко впізнати. Ми знаємо пару дуже добрих прикладів в Чехії, наприклад, ця віла Ісландероя, і ця вся історія, як її реставрували, і як серйозно до цього підходили. В ширшому контексті вся ця архітектура, в якому вона стані, яке ставлення чехів до цієї архітектури, вона їм подобається, вони її люблять, вони нею пишаються.
You have mentioned the reconstruction of the Villa Tugendhat. I think it was a crucial moment from many point of view. For instance, there was enough money. Maybe there was too much money for the Villa Tugendhat. European money and also money from the city of Brno, which is owning the house night nowadays. So. And also that was possible to organize a supervising group of experts and we met maybe 3 or 4 times in a year and checked the steps during the time of reconstruction. So, and sometimes we also protested against some procedures and asked the mayor of the city to change the strategy and to do it after our recommendation. And when the villa was reconstructed, the tourism to Brno was rapidly growing, and it was not the, we would say, the cheapest tourism, but really, we would say, middle class cultural tourism. So the city of Brno recognized that it has a big impact on the prestige of the city and also international acceptance of the city of Brno. But of course, it's a rare example. The same happened with the Miller House in Prague, which is also in the center of interest of foreigners and especially architects and art historians who are coming to Prague. But this is a problem, for instance, if we would like to reconstruct one dormitory by Fuchs or one school by Fuchs, because there are not 5 windows or 10 windows, there are 80 windows. So it is a more expensive operation in the big scale. So all the time there are problems that in buildings are changed windows and replaced by plastic windows, etc. But slowly, I think there is a little bit more acceptance for this architecture. It's not. It's a serious problem in Moscow. If you see there is only the one example of Nikolaev Collective House, which was reconstructed, but it's also. I would say the problem of discussion if it is right by such way, but there are these Klub Zujev, Klub Rusakov, etc., which need intervention very soon. Otherwise, we will have archaeological excavations of modern architecture everywhere in Moscow. And also in Poland, situation is not very good because there is a lot of social housing, for instance, in Silesia, designed by good German architects before the war, and every flat had different new windows. So the original unity of the architecture is disappearing. So there should be also done more. On other hand, there was done a lot for the reconstruction of the exhibition area in Scheidning, in Zhytnický Park, with the Century Hall, which is now listed as a UNESCO building, which is quite interesting example because it's a German building on Polish territory nowadays. And it was possible to succeed with this proposal, and now it is listed in international UNESCO list of monuments. So it's a problem which we will face even in future.
Щоб продовжити цю тему, тому що я думаю, що всі, хто тут зібралися і цікавляться архітектурою сучасною і переживають за її стан, і це по всій нашій країні відбувається, і дійсно, як Ірина правильно сказала, це велика проблема. Що б ви нам порадили, які найкращі методи популяризації для людей, які не знаються на цій архітектурі і не дуже нею цікавляться? Тому що очевидно, що, наприклад, більш старша архітектура барокова і з інших періодів, вона така, можна сказати, зрозуміла всім, що її треба оберігати, і то не завжди це відбувається. От як з досвіду Чехії, з вашого особистого, як би ви порадили, якими методами, через що популяризувати і якось змусити людей полюбити цю архітектуру, якомога більше людей?
Це again eternal question. I can tell you two examples. One day visited me when I was dean in Prague, a German architect, Hans Busse von Busse, who was architect in Munich, and he built, for instance, a city archive in Munich, and he built the new Franz Josef Airport in Munich. And so I thought he will not know Prague. I will offer him a guided tour through Prague, and he was laughing. He told, I spent my childhood in Prague. And because his father, who was a very high bureaucrat, but not party member, and he behaved so well, Czech people have transferred the family to American sector at the end of the war and saved their lives. So that way he had a very good connection to Prague, also because they had a Czech cook who cooked for the German family the best Czech delicatesses. And he told me that he attended the French school, which I have shown you. And that way he became architect. This is one case. Second case was we moved from the prefabricated estate to bigger flat because we had four children to Vinohrady. And my wife told me, yes, I agree, we can move, but you have to find a place for our youngest daughter in kindergarten. So I visited kindergarten, and then the directrice asked me, what is her address? So I told Slovinska 23. It's impossible. You should go to another kindergarten. Why you would like to have your daughter in this kindergarten? And I told her, because it is nice building. And it was a cultural shock for her. She thought the grandmother is nearby, or for instance, maybe the directrice is a charming lady, or I don't know. And I told her that the building is nice. So she remained silent, I think half a minute, and then she told me, I accepted your daughter. So you have to start already in kindergarten. And it is a long procedure, not only for us and for families, but also for school and city administration, because architecture is a existential part of our life. if we want or if we don't want, we are confronted with the architecture from the birth to the death. And I am happy that I was born in very nice building designed by Viennese architect Villa Primavesi in Olomouc. And I hope that I will have a relatively good gravestone for the last rest.
Наступне запитання.
Не запитання, а продовження, тому що, як ми побачили з вашої лекції, архітектура не є лише про форму, вона є про зміст, не тільки про функцію, але про ідеї і про людей, які в них живуть, і людей, які архітектуру будують, а чи архітектори, чи будівничі, ну і замовники, які є важлива частина. І коли ми подумаємо про Україну і про архітектуру модернізму, тобто яка вона є в занепаді, і як нам її зберігати, вона дасть мені до того питання, що ми маємо дуже яскраві приклади архітектури модернізму, але вони є частиною історії, які не до кінця у нас інтегровані. Вони є частиною спроби побудови нової радянської України. Вони є частиною спроби побудувати і створити Чехословацьку республіку. Вони є спробою створити, яку можна, другу Республіку Польську. Тобто це і приватні ініціативи, але це і частина державних проєктів. І це є цей спадок, ці будинки, які, щоб їх розуміти, нам складно їх розуміти лише через історію архітектури, як через історію стилю і форми. Нам потрібно, і нам складно, напевно, не до кінця приємно, тому що треба говорити в інший спосіб про історії людей, які тут жили, ці будинки будували. Ці будинки замовляли, але з іншого боку, як, коли ви згадали цю виставку про львівський модернізм у Вроцлаві, яка зараз є у Кракові, і це є виставка про ідею, форми, і вже у Кракові більше про людей, які там жили, але як показати цю виставку у Львові, щоб не викреслити людей, які живуть в цих будинках останні 50 років, знову ж таки. І це для нас такий, тобто це є історія архітектури, яка не є про історію архітектури, а є про історію людей в кінці. От, і мені здається, що це є захопливий, але дуже складний і складений проєкт, щоб оцінити цю, якби, цю різношерстість, різночастковість, різність модерністичної архітектури в сучасній Україні. Десь така. Тобто дякую, що ви, звісно, вийшли за форму і за вигляд, а показали процеси і творення. Дякую.
Дякую. Якщо продовжити те, що ви зараз сказали про будинок, де ви народилися, і я знаю, що ви жили і творили, і писали, і викладали в багатьох дуже важливих для Чехії містах. Чи хотіли б ви в якомусь із цих місць народитись, а не в Оломовці, наприклад, яке би потім впливало з самого народження на ваш світогляд?
This is interesting question. I never was thinking that I would be born somewhere else.
Just imagine.
I was produced during the first holidays of my parents in High Tatra. This was a little shock for the family because I have not been born alone. I have twin sister. So these holidays ended with a big growth of the family, not in the best time. And my parents have been with friends during these holidays in High Tatra. Interesting, it was in the building designed by Dušan Jurkovič, a famous Slovak architect. And then friends of my parents told after this action, Schlapetas, for them is now Matterhorn forbidden. Instead of High Tatra, they used Matterhorn. But Matterhorn was forbidden for everybody because nobody could travel to Switzerland after 48. And so this was the first step.
Yes.
The second step that was that I was born in Villa Primavesi, which is a Jugendstil villa in Olomouc. The Hedda Primavesi, this was the model for Gustav Klimt paintings. And I think the bathroom where I got first shower was designed by Josef Hoffmann.
It's okay, it's enough.
And I think
to
it's
understand.
Enough. But I am not living in very, very simple conditions, unfortunately. Not in such high standards, because I was not so so wealthy to build a family house.
Thank you, but it was enough to. Вибачте. Але цього було достатньо, щоб оця родина, в якій ви народилися, родина архітектора плюс ця віла, це вже дуже багато для того, щоб сформувати вас як таку особистість, так?
It could be also different. My son was very good as a draftsman. He always made sketches of crocodiles and elephants, so he became veterinary physician. So I have to let him to do what he wants. I had a dream that one of child could be doctor, physician. But probably my son has seen the shape of my body, so I decided to study veterinary.
І які тварини? Я чула, що у вас є вдома. Що ви маєте вдома тварину, це логічно, якщо він ветеринар, і у вас є домашня тварина. Pet.
No, we have only one snake at home. Because son has left, but the snake remained with us.
Як його звати?
I have no connection with him.
He
doesn't know architectural language, so he's communicating with my wife.
Якщо повернутись до архітектури, можна ще задати вам запитання, яке мені дуже цікаво. Рондо кубізм, який я знаю, дуже має багато назв, а ви додали ще одну. Про яку я ще не чула, сосисковий стиль, але так чи інакше це такий варіант арт-деко, який існував тільки на території Першої Чехословацької Республіки, тобто національний стиль. От зараз, в часи, коли така ідея інтернаціональної архітектури по всьому світу, і ми бачимо тільки якісь особистісні почерки. Чи бачили ви, мандруючи чи вивчаючи архітектуру, якесь таке явище, як от національний стиль в межах, в рамках сучасної архітектури? Чи це можливо взагалі і чи ви бачили? Як от такий виразний стиль, можливо, от, який можна порівняти з ротокубізмом 20-х років?
This title, Sausage Architecture, is my title, because I am always afraid that the audience is already sleeping, so I have to do something to awake them. But in fact, I heard it first time from Professor Kola from Bratislava. He used sausages on the facade, so I am repeating this term. But the same phenomenon was, for instance, in Slovenia by different way. Ivan Vornik architecture in Ljubljana, for instance. Nowadays, it's an interesting question. I think, for instance, Alvaro Sira is very, very well connected with the tradition of Portuguese architecture. If you are walking through such cities like, for instance, Coimbra, and you can see the a real living dialogue of buildings, even smaller buildings on the fantastic and dramatic topography of the city, you can read where is coming from the inspiration for Alvaro Sisa. I think we have to take the tradition by creative way, and Sisa is a good example for it, for instance. You can be also inspired by poetry.
Yes.
I think Frank Lloyd Wright was very much inspired by Walt Whitman. So I always try to recommend architects to read a lot of poetry. That's important. And to play piano, for instance.
Хороша порада. Дуже дякую за відповідь. І я від себе, я настільки захоплена була лекцією і Мені було мало, чесно кажучи, ну, мало в хорошому сенсі, тобто я би вас слухала і слухала, що навіть не встигла подякувати, тому дякую від себе особисто зараз. І, можливо, зараз ще є запитання, це, якщо ви ще не втомилися.
Дякую, в першу чергу, за чудову лекцію. Було дуже цікаво провести час. І я так спочатку про поверхню лекції, те, що я так відібрав в міру якоїсь ангажованості або зацікавленості. Дуже багато про державотворчі процеси в цій архітектурі, про націєтворчі процеси. Ну, це зрозуміло, це міжвоєнний період, Центральна Європа. Дуже багато про середній клас і про великий бізнес. Ну, там було про батю, ще про кілька підприємств. І дуже мало, ну, взагалі, про соціальну сферу. Первинно там був приклад з клінікою. У мене таке питання до вас. Чи є якісь приклади архітекторів чехословацьких, які думали про якусь таку велику утопію, велику модерністичну утопію, яка не скеровувалася на середній клас, а дбала первинно про якусь гуманістичність, або, якщо так дещо спрощувати і повертатися до класовості, дбала про робочий клас? Таке моє питання. Дякую.
I mentioned these houses for existential minimum, these utopian projects of collective houses from Prague competitions 1930-31, which have not built, but after the war they have been built two collective houses. I can show them these two collective houses. One in Litvinov and one in Zlín. They are both very beautiful, but interesting is I personally prefer the Zlín collective house designed by my professor Jiří Voženilek, because the bigger one in Litvinov has already very huge scale, and this big scale is then danger. There was a there have been two utopian projects which have been developed at the turn of 30s or 40s and in the and during the war. Project for sanation of Holešovice district as a new city business center by Professor Emanuel Hruška, who was after the war professor of urban planning in Bratislava. And then there was a project for a radical sanation of Prague city designed by Josef Havlíček, who was inspired by Plan Voisin by Le Corbusier. And so, like Corbusier wanted to destroy everything in the center of Paris, he also wanted to keep only coulisses of Wenceslas Square and to destroy everything except of a few monasteries and build three pyramidal skyscrapers in the center of Prague. Luckily, it was not built. But if you are speaking about the mix of classes, I think it was something what was brought to us when Siedlungen have been built, especially prefabricated estates. When I lived, we lived 9 years with my family in Prague, Novodvorská estate, and it was quite nice apartment, 72 square meters, but with 4 children, piano. At the time it was still without snake, but with my big library it was a little bit too much. But interesting was this mixture. In this house lived a top physician from main hospital in Prague and engineers and normal people without higher education. So this was a special phenomenon of socialist time that classes have been mixed. Now it is disappearing again, and some of these estates are becoming more or less like a slum. I think this is a common phenomenon. I think it will happen also in Poland and everywhere. So it will have also then consequences for the. But I think Czech society was not so differentiated like in Vienna, because Czechs had not so many wealthy people. Wealthy people have been some Germans, some Jewish, and some nobility. And Czechs have been mostly middle class, and this class of engineers, which was important also for Austrian industry, like Kaplan, who invented turbine at first in Brno and then in Viennese Technical University, etc., etc. So we will see how the what kind of impact it will have on the society in future. I think you can feel it already today.
Але місто, саме місто Злін, це теж приклад цієї утопії. Тобто ці будинки, про які пан професор згадував, маленькі, на чотири родини, вони так само були втіленням цієї ідеї соціального житла. І це місто за 10 років збільшилось 20 разів. Тобто працівники жили в таких хороших умовах і туди приїжджали залюбки, тому що це вже був соцпакет, прав, якщо я не помиляюсь. Можливо, є ще якісь запитання в когось?
Ці будинки, коли будувалися в ті часи, вони були якби соціальними будинками. А чи можна два слова, як ці будинки живуть зараз? Хто там живе, як вони використовуються?
No, they have not been social. It was not built so many social housing projects. If you compare social housing in Germany, it was completely different scale. 135,000 apartments in Berlin between 1925 and to 1932 in 7 years. Such action we had not. Also, the crisis probably was not so difficult, so critical as in Germany. Consequence was the Nazi regime also. Of course, there was a crisis because the highest unemployment in Czechoslovakia was in May 1933, and it was something like 900,000 unemployed people. It was relatively already very high unemployment. But then came the second boom, which was, of course, reduced by the preparation of military conditions, because it was expected that one day Hitler will attack. So a lot of investment has gone to build a fortification around the country, which was difficult to defend, as you can see the map. And also the fortification system was planned that it will be finished, first stage will be finished 1942 and second 1947. So the war was already over. So it was not successful. For instance, the French secondary school is regarded as a really prominent school until now, and I don't know better school until now in the whole Czechoslovakia. So I think the level of schools is still influential. Hospitals, this is a little problem because, of course, the equipment, technological equipment, the hospitals change radically, so it's changing also the conditions inside of hospitals. So there are a lot of changes, and even more, of course, in the industry. It's very difficult to keep industrial buildings or to convert them to another function. But as I told you, these examples, Villa Tugendhat, Villa Miller, or also reconstruction, for instance, of Black Rose Arcade, they are also a contribution to cultural tourism. So, but I think we have to work on the architecture tradition and understanding for architecture from early childhood. That's why I ask sometimes when students are coming to exam if they know where they have been born.
Але от питання уже для тих, хто народився в цих прекрасних будинках модернізму в Україні. Я знаю по Ужгороду, що люди, які там живуть, вони не уявляють, яка цінність, і вони мене це дуже дивує. Вони не бачать цієї фактури фасадного тиньку, не бачать цих матеріалів, з яких зроблені сходові марші. І як пояснити тим, хто вже народився і закінчив школу, грубо кажучи, оце питання, з яким ми постійно стикаємось. Не знаю.
This is a long process and I think also the introduction of Stalinist doctrine was a reaction on modern constructivism, which was not accepted by people who came from villages to live in Moscow, and they have never been confronted with such style, which was typical for Western society. So it was also a phenomenon which caused then the development of Stalin style. And opposite side, then you had Khrushchevki in 50s everywhere, and in Moscow, I think regarding Khrushchev's speech as a liberation from Stalinist doctrine, and Moscow architects told me that this was a funeral speech for architects by Khrushchev. So you can see it from the both sides of the river, from both embankments.
От ви зараз говорили про оновлення і нове життя будівель. Я читала про цей проєкт синагоги в Жиліні, недалеко від нас, в Словаччині, від самого Петера Беренса. І я знаю, що теж я бачила інтерв'ю, в якому ви казали, що і ваш батько теж, можливо, був причетний. Може, ви можете розказати щось про цей якесь от нове життя будівель, можливо, на прикладі цієї синагоги як культурного центру, або, можливо, якийсь цікавий приклад в Чехії також вам.
Синагоги Жилина. I think the reason why my father was asked to design a conversion of this building was that he won competition for theater in Martin, which is nearby, and he became friend of leading Slovak theater directors, and they have given him few commissions to reconstruct Slovak theaters, and it was a luckily moment which helped my father to survive, because he had political problems, and Slovaks have carried him over the water when he worked for Slovakian territory. And probably through this connection he was also asked to make a proposal for conversion of the synagogue. But the time was quite difficult, and my father was not employed in state office, so he had no power behind him, so nothing was realized from his project. I think the conversion to concert hall is not so bad for synagogue when the situation was that there was no hope to keep the synagogue in the original function. So I hope now they will succeed to do it by a good way in Žilina.
І в Чехії теж є такі приклади реконструкції якогось важливого центру на культурний центр міста, яке зараз могло би бути туристичним центром і привабливим для туристів і місцевих так само.
Nice example is Musée d'Orsay in Paris. On the embankment of the Seine, the Museum of Impressionism is now located in the former museum, former rail station. So such examples you have everywhere. And but there is a lot of problems with industrial buildings, And it is permanently part of the discussion of preservation offices. And it depends also who is the owner of the building and what is the cost problem, of course.
Наскільки важливим є бажання людей? Тобто у нас зараз така ситуація, знову ж таки, повертаючись до України, що дуже часто такі, як їх називають, низові ініціативи, тобто не з боку держави ідея, а люди самоорганізовуються і щось утворюють, ну або дійсно якісь певний бізнесмен чи бізнес, які мають цікаві ідеї, втілюють їх в життя. Наскільки, от, ви, можливо, ви знаєте такі приклади успішні, коли люди захотіли щось зробити з цікавою будівлею, в якій, наприклад, стояло питання, чи знищити її, чи дати їй ще шанс?
There are several examples which have been saved by initiatives of private groups or small foundations. So this is a process also, and I think this is always a problem that the government and city offices are not ready. Like long time, no modern building was protected as a memorial. It started at first in 80s, and nowadays it's a change. Now people are trying also to protect some buildings from communist time, and some of them have really value, but it is always problems of the cost, of the owner, etc. I heard just a few days ago again a discussion about the television tower in Liberec, which is quite famous, but I think there is a private owner, and it is a little hardly to implement a complete reconstruction, etc. So the governor of the Northern Bohemia has spoken in television that he will now speak directly to the premier minister, etc. So it should be integrated also the political side in such cases.
Дякую. Можливо, за цей час якісь запитання ще з'явились? Якщо ні, то величезне дякую. І велика подяка від нас усіх. І я так розумію, що багато ужгородців дивляться зараз трансляцію. І багато моїх знайомих хотіли би запросити вас, і я від їхнього імені запрошую вас до Ужгорода, якщо буде можливість, і ви будете десь поруч, в Словаччині або знову у Львові, то завітайте, будь ласка, з лекцією до нас, і ми будемо дуже раді вас побачити і почути в Ужгороді. І дякую. Величезне дякую.
Thank my interpreter. It was a hard work. Please applause for the. Thank you, Sofia and Lina. They supported me that I have not collapsed during the lecture.